tonight's meeting of the pension committee. I'd particularly like to welcome those who do travel all the way to be here with us tonight. Treena, you're sitting next to John, who's travelled all the way since Helens, so welcome here. And also, particularly Norm, then I know Norm, who travels from Knowsley Council. And we also have
from Birkenhead.
Anyway, welcome everybody. It's a pleasure to have you all here. Good attendance tonight, so I really appreciate that. I don't consider we'll be here all night. It's not a complicated agenda that we have before tonight. Obviously, we're generally on to ask questions as the meeting progresses. First of all, is there any declarations of interest?
Can I just say good evening, first chair, and the pension funds.
I was just an interest because my wife is a member of the pension fund.
I'll do the social. Okay. Meeting chairman, my top fund. Until my name.
Until then, yeah. Okay, thank you very much for doing that. We have before us the minutes of the previous meeting held on the 15th of September. For those who'd like to have a chance to read them in full. Is everybody happy that there are accurate records of the meeting? Matters arising from those minutes. There is one item actually I'd just like to draw your attention to. Actually, item 37 of those minutes. It talks about the annual employers conference, which a date for our diary is next Thursday at Entry Race Course. And I'd just like a guy just to run us through the arrangements for that, please.
Thank you, Chair. Yes, so reported at the September Pensions Committee was the date for the annual employers conference for the pension portal, which is next Thursday.
Update, and the one has heard a report for us on that.
paragraph 8 refers to the increasing cost of the LGPS and confirms that the proposal on cost management will help to protect employees against the rising cost of longevity. The recommendation is that members of the board have to take any questions.
There is a recommendation, we know the content of the report, is everyone happy?
how we invite nominations for seats on the pension board and the selection and appointment procedures, which must be by an open and transparent process. We need to detail the rhythm and training programme and develop the content and format of reports and acts. The admin authority must have approved the composition and state of reference of the board by April, but it doesn't have to be fully operational until the 1st of July. As we've been giving periods of grace due to the latest publication of the fund of the final regs and guidelines. Section 4 highlights the risk of non-compliance with the regulations due to the amount of work required and the challenging timescales of the board by the day of the April. Section 9 confirms that any costs associated with the pension board will reduce the administration costs charged. The recommendation is to note the contents of the report and the requirements for the Council to establish a pension board by the 1st of April 2015, and that members authorise officers to work with the admin authority to establish a pension board within the issued guidelines. Details will be reported to the January
Thank you very much, Chair. In relation to the comments in the 2.5 and 2.4, how many members of the authority would be required to accommodate this? Do we have a figure in mind or is it a local one? The second part of that question is, as it states in the reports in the previous one, will members of this particular selection to be part of that in the state's recovery rate?
It's actually mandatory to have two employer reps and two member reps as well, but due to the size of mid-sized pension funds and employers within the funds, we feel that it is perhaps more representative to have a large number of employers to reflect the different employer bases that we have, statutory employers, community admission bodies and academies, that we need to be thinking about the correct selection of funds and then funds. And your second point, yes, that's correct. If you are actually engaged with the discharge of the management of the LGPS as members of the pension committee, will not be allowed to sit on the pension board because that would be seen as a conflict of interest, as the role of the pension board is actually to assist the committee in administering the scheme.
Report, Chair, and I move the recommendations.
Thank you. Okay, we're happy to go with that recommendation. Really, thank you. Thanks, Yvonne. The next agenda item is to do with auditors' corporate signatures, and it's fairly comprehensive and detailed, but perhaps if we could ask Donna to just walk us through that.
Yes, thank you, Chair. The reason for bringing the report is that one of the previous authorised signatories, Paddy Dowell, has left the fund and he's been replaced by Linda DeForge. So that is reflected under Section 2 with the current and revised signatories. In addition, under 2.6, we've taken the opportunity to expand the number of officers able to exercise power of attorney on behalf of NDF and Rural Council, just to make sure that officers are available should that be required.
So the question I asked the briefing report, have the number of signatories stayed the same, would we say, over the last 3 years, or have we got more? I can understand why you need a comfortable amount, because if you read 3.1, there's a financial risk of 7 to delayed transactions and 7 to trades out there. So have we got the same amount as the more or less?
Yes, thank you, Councillor. The overall number
Just on that, in response to that comment, that we reduced the numbers. Nothing against what we need to control, we have a fixed number. We need a set amount of members of staff to be able to sign off the checks at any one particular time. Obviously, people in time, but how easily are we to be present and make sure that some of these schools are. In terms of staff leaving, we can very quickly take away access to systems. In terms of adding small class signatures, it is only done with the authority of this committee. So with our committee meetings each year, there is a small delay before we can add names to this management.
Thank you. Well, sorry, Paul. I've got to ask the question again about the numbers piece, because there isn't financial risk in checks are in place, and doesn't the chair have delegated powers to give it on to another secretary? In other words, why wait until January for the next committee meeting if somebody leaves in the meantime? That's what I'm asking.
I don't know the answer to that. I'm not sure.
Okay, thank you for that. It's quite a detailed report. And, thank you. Can I just add the fact that we as members need to be aware of our responsibilities as well as members of this committee, so perhaps we can reflect on that. The next item on the agenda is the LGC Investment Conference, and again, Peter is going to give us some information on that.
Yes, thank you, Chair. This is held next year. 26th to 27th February, the closest Friday is at Chester Conference. It is actually 7 miles outside Chester, down at Harvard Park.
open to all members. That's the recommendation. If we're happy just to approve that as it is, then we can do so. Happy to approve that as it is.
Great.
Recommendation.
Excellent.
Okay. Alright, so on to agenda item 8, which has an appendix attached which is exempt. However, I'd like to ask you to consider the minutes of the investment monitoring working party, which we're required to have, the minutes in question of the 11th of September and the 9th of October. And for those who are in attendance, I'm happy to approve the minutes. There was an amendment to the minutes, which was pointed out to us by a member of the general public, quite rightly so, which George wasn't in attendance at the particular meeting in question, so happy to make that amendment. But other than that, is those who are in attendance happy to approve the minutes as they stand? Okay, thank you. So the next agenda item is actually introduction to the exempt item, which is item number 10. So I'd like to thank the members of the public for their attendance at tonight's meeting. Section 100A, before the local contact the public be excluded from the meeting during consideration of the following items of business on the grounds, therefore, the lengthy disclosure of exempt information as defined by the government powers of Scheme 12A as amended to that act. So, thank you for your attendance tonight. We'll go to the exempt item for the agenda. So, happy to propose and second that.